I'm gonna read from a band book. Johnny Guy's Gun was probably the first band book that I ever read when I was about 9 years old. And read it for my brother. Lying on your back without anything to do and anywhere to go was kind of like being on a high hill far away from noise and people. It was like being on a camping trip all by yourself. You had plenty of time to think. You had time to figure things out. Things you never thought of before. Things like, for example, going to war. You were so completely alone on your hill that noise and people didn't enter in your figuring of things at all. You figured only for yourself without considering a single little thing outside yourself. It seemed like you thought clearer and that your answers made more sense. And even if they didn't make it a sense, it didn't matter because you weren't ever going to be able to do anything about them anyhow. He thought, here, you are John Bonham lying like a side of beef all the rest of your life, and for what? Somebody tapped you on your shoulder and said, come along, son, we're going to war. So you went, but why? In any other deal, even like buying a car or running an errand, you had the right to say what's there in it for me. Otherwise, you'd be buying bad cars for too much money or running errands for fools and starving to death. It was a kind of duty you owed yourself that when anybody said, come on, son, do this or do that, you should stand up and say, look, mister, why should I do this for? For who am I doing it, and what am I going to get out of it in the end? But when a guy comes along and says, come with me and risk your life, and maybe die or be crippled, why then, you've got no rights. You haven't even the right to say yes or no or think it over. There are plenty of laws to protect guys' money even in the wartime, but there's nothing on books that says a man's life is his own. Of course, a lot of guys were ashamed. Somebody said, let's go out and fight for liberty. And so they went and got killed without ever once thinking about liberty. And what kind of liberty were they fighting for anyhow, or anyway? How much liberty and whose idea of liberty? Were they fighting for the liberty of eating free ice cream cones all their lives, or for the liberty of robbing anybody they pleased whenever they wanted to, or what? You tell a man he can't rob and you take away some of his liberty? You've got to. What the hell does liberty mean anyhow? It's just a word like house or table or any other word, only it's a special kind of word. A guy says house and he can point to a house to prove it. But a guy says, come on, let's fight for liberty, and he can't show you liberty. He can't prove the thing he's talking about, so how the hell can he be telling you to fight for it? No, sir. Anybody who went out and got into a frontline trenches to fight for liberty was a goddamn fool, and the guy who got him there was a liar. Next time anybody can come gabbling to him about liberty, what did he mean next time? There wasn't going to be any next time for him, but the hell with that. If there could be a next time and somebody said, let's fight for liberty, he would say, mister, my life is important. I'm not a fool, and when I swap my life for liberty, I've got to show in advance what liberty is and whose idea of liberty we're talking about, and just how much of that liberty we're going to have. And what's more, mister, are you as much interested in this liberty as you want me to be? And maybe too much liberty will be as bad as too little liberty, and I think you're a goddamn four-flusher because through your hat, and I've already decided that I like the liberty I've got here, the liberty to walk and see and hear and talk and eat and sleep with my girl. I think I like that liberty better than fighting for a lot of things we won't get and ending up without any liberty at all. Ending up dead and rotting before my life has even begun. Good, or ending up like a side of beef. Thank you, mister. You fight for liberty. Me? I don't care for some. They were always fighting for something, the bastards. And if anyone dare say the hell with fighting, it's all the same each war. Each war is like the other, and nobody gets any good out of it. Why they hollered coward? If they weren't fighting for liberty, they were fighting for independence or democracy or freedom or decency or honor or their native land or something else that didn't mean anything. The war was to make the world safer, democracy for the little countries, for everybody. If the war was over now, then the world must be all safe for democracy. Was it? What kind of democracy? And how much? And whose? Then there was this freedom the little guys were always getting killed for. Was it freedom for another country? Freedom from work or disease or death? Freedom from your mother-in-law? Please, mister, give us a bill of sales on this freedom before we go out and get killed. Give us a bill of sales drawn up plainly so we know in advance what we're getting killed for. And give us also a first mortgage on something as security so we can be sure after we've won your war and that we've got the same kind of freedom we've bargained for. For Christ's sakes, give us things to fight for and we can see and feel and pin down and understand. No more highfalutin words that mean nothing, like native land, motherland, fatherland, homeland, native land. It's all the same. What the hell good to you is your native land after you're dead? Whose native land is it after you're dead? If you get killed fighting for your native land, you've bought a pig and a poke. You've paid for something you've never collected. And when they couldn't hook the little guy into fighting for liberty, our freedom, our democracy, our independence, our decency of honor, they tried the woman. Look at that dirty Huns. They would say, look at them, how they raped the beautiful French and Belgian girls. Somebody's got to stop all this raping. So come on, little guy, join the army and save the beautiful French and Belgian girls. So the little guy got bewildered, and he signed up, and in a little while, a shell hit him, and his life spattered out on him in red meat, pulp, and he was dead. Dead for another word, and all the fence old bats of the DAR get out and hurrah themselves hoarse over his grave because he died for womanhood. And when armies begin to move and flags wave and slogans pop up, watch out, little guy, because it's somebody else's chestnut in the fire, not yours. It's words you're fighting for, and you're not making an honest deal, your life, for something better. You're being noble, and after you've killed the thing you traded your life for, won't do you any good. And chances are it won't do anybody else any good either. Maybe that's a bad way to think. There are lots of idealists around who will say they have to, that we've got so low that nothing is more precious than life. Surely there are ideals worth fighting for or even dying for. If not, then we are worse for the beasts of the field and have sunk into barbarity. Then you say, that's all right. Let's be barbarous just as long as we don't have war. You keep your ideals just as long as they don't cost me my life. And they say, but surely life isn't as important as principle. Then you say, oh no. Maybe not yours, but mine is. What the hell is principle? Name it, and you can have it. You can always hear the people who are willing to sacrifice somebody else's life. There's plenty loud, and they talk all the time. You can find them in churches and schools and newspapers and legislatures and Congress. That's their business. They sound wonderful. Death before dishonor. This ground sanctified by blood. These men who died so glorious, they shall not have died in vain. Our noble dead. But what do the dead say? Did anybody ever come back from the dead? Any single one of the millions who got killed? Did any one of them ever come back and say, by God, I'm glad I'm dead because death is always better than dishonor? Did they say, I'm glad I died to make the world safe for democracy? Did they say, I like death better than losing liberty? Did any of them ever say it? It's good to think I've got my guts blown out for the honor of my country. Did any of them ever say, look at me, I'm dead, but I died for decency, and that's better than being alive? Did any of them ever say, I've been rotting for 2 years in a foreign grave, but it's wonderful to die for your native land? Did any of them say, hooray, I died for womanhood, and I'm happy. See how I sing, even though my mouth is choked with worms? Nobody. But the dead know whether all these things people talk about are worth dying for or not. And the dead can't talk. So the words about noble death and sacred blood and honor are all put into dead lips by grave robbers and fakes who have no right to speak for the dead. If a man says death before dishonor, he is either a fool or a liar because he doesn't know what death is. He isn't able to judge. He only knows about living. He doesn't know about anything about dying. If he is a fool and believes in death before dishonor, let him go ahead and die. But all the little guys who are too busy to fight should be left alone. And all the guys who say death before dishonor is pure bull. The important thing is life before death. They should be left alone too. Because the guys who say life isn't worth living without some principle, so important you're willing to die for, they are all nuts. And the guys who say, you'll see there'll come a time when you can't escape. You're going to have to fight and die because it'll mean your very life. Why, they are also nuts. They're also talking like fools. They're saying that two and two makes nothing. They're saying that a man will have to die in order to protect his life. If you agree to fight, you agree to die. Now, if you die to protect your life, you aren't alive anyhow. So how is there any sense in a thing like that? A man doesn't say, I will starve myself to death to keep from starving. He doesn't say, I will spend all of my money in order to save my money. He doesn't say, I will burn my house down in order to keep it from burning. Why then should he be willing to die for the privilege of living? There ought to be at least as much common sense about living and dying as there is about going to the grocery store and buying a loaf of bread. And all the guys who died, all the 5 million or 7 million or 10 million who went out and died to make the world safer for democracy, to make the world safe for words, without meaning, how did they feel about it just before they died? How did they feel as they watched their blood pump out into the mud? How did they feel when the gas hit their lungs and began eating them all? How did they feel as they lie crazed in hospitals and looked death straight in the face and saw him come and take them? If the thing they are fighting for was important enough to die for, then it was also important enough for them to be thinking about in the last minute of their lives. That stood to reason. Life is awfully important, so if you're giving it away, you have to think with all of your mind in the last moments of your life about the thing you traded it for. So did all those kids die thinking of democracy and freedom and liberty and honor and the safety of home and the stars and the stripes forever? You're goddamn right they did.